Thank you for your word. The entrance of your word, it gives light and it gives understanding to the simple. We ask, Lord, open our understanding this hour. Speak to your children. In Jesus' perfect name.
Amen.
Anointing for prosperity, part 3. Open the book of Genesis chapter 26. Verse 1 to 15. I'm not going to read all of now. I'm going to paraphrase. And also Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse 18. And the Bible says, but thou shalt remember the Lord thy God. Deuteronomy 8 and 18. For it is he that giveth the power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which he swore to thy fathers. So, prosperity is a covenant that God has with the church. It's not a sin to prosper. It is not. You see, poverty is not a sign of holiness. Please pay attention. Lack is not a sign of humility. Poverty is not a sign of righteousness. I will shock you. Prosperity is even a sign of righteousness. For I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health even as thy soul prospereth. Psalm 35 verse 27, the Bible says, God delight in the prosperity of his servants. So I'd like you to settle down now and get your heart and yourself excited, because God has a good plan for us. Amen.
Amen.
God has a glorious plan for every one of his child. When I look at my children, I get excited because they have a glorious future. Even before they make any decision, I've already made some good decisions for them and helped them to walk into that decision. so that tomorrow there will be nothing like regret or had I known. Am I talking to us this morning? Just as I'm making plans for my children. So God has a glorious plan to prosper you, to fill you with His glory, to make your life better. And the only way God has done all this is to reveal it in His word. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has entered into the heart of man the thing that God has prepared for them that love Him, but He has revealed it unto us by His Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yet the deep things of God. The things God has prepared for you, you cannot even fathom it. What you are seeing right now, they are just the manifestation of the blessing. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. So God has glorious plans for you and I. And He has revealed them to us by His Spirit in the Word of God. And today we want to look at taking risk to prosper. We began with prosperity mindset. Amen?
Amen.
Prosperity mindset. Now, before I go further, the chapter where we just opened up, Genesis chapter 26, from verse 1 to 15, I will paraphrase. The Bible said there was a famine that was in the days of Isaac, just like the kind of famine that Abraham experienced. So famine is not a new thing. It has been happening before. The Bible said there is nothing new under the heavens. Am I talking now? So Isaac wanted to respond. I'm trying to paraphrase. Isaac wanted to respond to the famine because no sane person will sit down in a place where the famine is ravaging the land. Now, people were living the land of Philistine where Isaac was, just like the crisis that is happening all over the world now. You know, refugees flocking from Syria, from Lebanon, from Iraq, heading towards Europe. Sometimes I watch them on telly, I ask myself, God, where are these people coming from? Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
They go in their millions. And each place they pass through, you could see the effect. Now, this was what was happening in the time of Isaac. People were living in their droves, in their thousands. Their family, they put them on cart and began to move. So Isaac, because like I said, no sane person will sit down and allow famine to destroy their family. Just like they are moving out of Syria because of the war. People are escaping war, refugee camps, so it's filled up. So people were leaving the land and Isaac too decided to leave. Please pay attention here. Isaac decided to leave. He now gathered his stuff and everything, took his family and his children, put them in the car. And as he was about to leave, the Bible says, and the Lord appeared to Isaac. When I saw something deeper this morning, when I was studying it, God did not send an angel to appear to Isaac. God had to, by himself, appear to Isaac. If God has sent an angel, Isaac would have asked the angel a question, are you blind? Can't you see what is happening around us? Are you still with me here? God had to by himself, because that is the only proof that Isaac will agree that this is God speaking. If an angel had come, he would have told the angel that, are you blind? Can't you see that people are dying of famine? So the Lord appeared to him and said, don't join this multitude living in this country. Stay here. I have a plan for you. And Isaac remained. Now, something happened. The moment he stayed there, that was a hostile environment. That was a place where men were perverts. Because if you read further, from verse 7 to verse number 11, you will discover that they came to ask him, is this your wife? He said, no, it's my sister, because they were perverts. And one day the king looked out through the window and saw Isaac playing with his wife. He said, boy, come here. This is indeed your wife. He said, yes. Why did you lie to us? One of my men would have taken her and slept with her. That's to let you know that they are perverts. Isaac said, I told you guys lies because I felt that they would kill me and take away my wife. And he was right. And the king now made a decree that any man who touches this man's wife or this man will be put to death. That was his security. Then from verse 12, Isaac did what was strange in the time of famine. I will come to that later on. Please pay attention. I'm trying to get your attention now. So that you will know that for you to prosper as a child of God in the kingdom, there are certain level of risk you must be prepared to take. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Prosperity in the kingdom is not for vegetable-hearted people. It's not for lazy. It's not for the weak. We began by talking about prosperity mindset. If your mind is not mentally sound, if you are not mentally alert to catch what God is saying to you, you may miss God. Your mind must be sound. Because God speaks to your spirit, and it is through your mind you receive what God says into your spirit. Please pay attention here. Now, the prosperity plan of God is something that people have not caught. The church, some people don't know what God is actually doing. Now, in the book of 3 John verse 2, I wish above all things that you will prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospereth. Now, there are prophetic scriptures indicating that God has a great plan of prosperity for the church. Prophetic scriptures. And one of the prophetic scriptures is in the book of Isaiah chapter 2, from verse 3 and 4. 2 and 3, sorry. Isaiah chapter 2, verse 2 and 3. And the same thing was repeated verbatim in the book of Micah chapter 4, verse 1 and 2. It shall come to pass in the last day that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established on top of the mountain. Do you think it is by ordinary hand that the mountain, the house of God, be established on top of the mountains? It takes prosperity. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
It takes wealth. It takes prosperity. In Zechariah chapter 1, verse 17, the Bible says, my city, through prosperity, shall yet be spread abroad. So the mountain of the Lord's house that will be established on top of the mountain takes prosperity. And after it has been established, it will now begin to draw men. Because success has a compelling attraction. If you are not succeeding, people may not notice you. But the very moment things begin to change, amen. You will now begin to see different kinds of people. Some will come with good intention, some will come with bad intention. But that is the good, the bad, and the ugly. Because prosperity, success, has a compelling attraction. No matter how you plan or pretend to be oblivious or ignorant of what somebody is experiencing in terms of prosperity, it can't be too long. Very soon you start recognizing it. Glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
It's also repeated in the book of Zechariah chapter 8 from verse 20 to verse 23. God is prophesying the last day's church will experience a bumper explosion of wealth. That's why Job said, when men are cast down, you will say there is a lifting up. If you check the book of Job chapter 25, you will see clearly there that God has a plan of expanding and blessing his people with wealth. Can I also shock you? You know that the strongest evangelism strategy is wealth. When you prosper and they show somebody that this God can prosper you, they will leave every other thing and follow you. Because verse 20 of Zechariah chapter 8, verse 23, he says, in those days that 10 men shall hold a sketch of he that is a Jew, and they will say, show me your God, for we have heard that God is with you. Is anybody here?
Yes, sir.
Now, we'll be able to touch some of these steps that God is taking to prosper his church. I talked about the mindset. If you don't think of prosperity, there's no how you will suddenly arrive in the land of prosperity. For as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. If the mind is always thinking of failure, there's no how you will mistakenly succeed. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Yes, praise the Lord. So we talked about the mindset of prosperity. That is having the mindset of prosperity because it begins with the mind. So if you are mentally bankrupt, there is no way you can enjoy kingdom prosperity. If you are mentally bankrupt. If you don't believe in your mind that God can bless you, there's no way you will experience the blessings of God. If thou can believe, all things are possible. Believing is in the mind. If thou can believe, praise God.
Hallelujah.
I said, praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We also talked about prosperity habits. Prosperity habit. And you know, prosperity habits centers on hard work. Christians who are not ready to work hard in their assignment, in what God has signed, you know, giving them to do, there is no way they can mistakenly fall into prosperity. The book of Ecclesiastes, the Bible says, whatever your hand findeth to do, do what? You didn't explain to me. Whatever your hand findeth to do, do what? Not just do it. Do it with all your might. All your might speaks about hard work. If you don't put yourself into your assignment, there is no way you will arrive in the land of success. My wife made a statement to me, was it last night? She said something. No, we're discussing. And she said, every Saturday, when you are preparing for service, I try as much as I can to avoid your environment. Because I have seen that, I see that you thrust yourself into it. You are so engrossed in what you are getting ready to bless God's people that I will make sure that nothing distracts you. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I know some ministers who Saturday, they're all over the place. And in the night, they will now begin to look for one verse of the scripture. What am I going to preach today? They'll stay with you 2 a.m. looking for what to preach. That's not how to do it. Come on, say hard work.
Hard work.
Come on, say hard work.
Hard work.
In whatever God has called you to do, if you don't invest hard work into it, if you don't put yourself, plug yourself into it, there's no how you will arrive in success, including your business, your job. So nobody can avoid hard work if they want to succeed. Praise the Lord. I've listened to some men who are great in their wealth. People like Donald Trump, Warren Buffett, and all the rest of them. If you hear them speak, they don't sleep like every other person. Some of them have about 2 or 3 hours sleep a day. They are always strategizing, working hard. They don't sleep. I don't know if you want to prosper in this church. Please get ready to work hard. Amen?
Amen.
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 So if you are too lazy to work hard, you are too lazy to prosper. Because even if they put you in the land of cap, listen. Have you noticed that some successful people, by the time they die and move on, their children will squander the wealth. And they will end up in zero. Because those children were not taught the principles of hard work. So they don't value what their father handed over to them. In every labor, there is profit. Glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
Now, I define, or last week we define prosperity as making steady progress in your given assignment. Come on, say steady progress.
Steady progress.
If the progress is stagnated, something is wrong. But if the progress is steady, then you're on your way. That's what prosperity is all about. Making steady progress by time. Making steady progress by time. Where you are this year, you're not going to remain that way this year.
Amen.
You're not going to remain like that. As long as 2015 has come and it is going, in 2016 you must go to the next level.
Amen.
You must go to the next level.
Amen.
But you have to embrace the principles of making it work. On how to make it work. Amen.
Amen.
Making steady progress. And it is God's will and pleasure that you prosper because it glorifies Him. He said, I wish above all things, whatever it is, that you will prosper and be in health even as your soul prosperous. Psalm 35 verse 27, God delights in your prosperity. God wants you to succeed. Amen. Making steady progress. I remember when this ministry started, to be honest with you. We went up to 20 in my living room. There were some few handful of people. But by the grace of God, we'll be making steady progress. As you put in hard work, your progress will now begin to manifest. Very soon, you will take wings and start to fly. Because my Bible said in the book of Job chapter 8 verse 7, though thy beginning may be small, amen, For thy later end shall greatly increase. That increase comes when you begin to put yourself into your work. Despise all the distractions, because the devil doesn't want you to succeed. So he'll be throwing things at you just to get your attention. All these things we are going through in terms of challenges and all that, Satan only wants your attention. And if you give him your attention, forget it, you'll be marking time. Come on, say, I refuse to mark time. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Now, I want to look at taking risk to prosper. For any man, any woman who want to succeed in the kingdom of God, you must be ready to take some level of risk. For Peter to walk on the water, he had to take a risk. No man has ever walked on the water in life, in history, except Peter, apart from Jesus. But he took a risk for him to step out of the boat and walk on the water. Let me even say this. You came to church this morning. You did not check the chair you are sitting down if it's going to carry your weight. You just gave all your weight on the chair. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
You have this element of trust that this chair will carry you, that you didn't even think about it. Amen?
Amen.
You never had any second of thought about the chair you were going to sit down. You just sat down and it's carrying you. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
So let's see what this risk is all about. Everything in life and destiny has some level of risk involved, including the service and the service of God. Do you know that serving God itself is a risk? Everything you do in life is a risk. Even serving the devil too is a risk. Hello? Now, let me tell you this, the level of risk involved in the service of God, and I'll come to some other things. Under the old covenant, please pay attention now. Under the old covenant, it is too risky to serve God. But yet, God commanded the people to serve Him. And He gave them the laws and the precepts. And putting everything together is about 319 altogether. And it is required that you obey every one of them by time. If you violate any of them, you're as good as a dead man. That is the risk involved in serving God under the old covenant. Under the old covenant, a woman who is going through her menstrual cycle cannot even come into the temple. If she violates it, it's as good as stoning to death. Very risky. Now, under the new covenant, serving God is also very, very risky. It's just that we're enjoying some levels of grace because we are under the dispensation of grace. Amen?
Amen?
So, everything we do in life involves some level of risk. Even getting married to the best, you have never known that person for life. You now said, I love this man, I love this woman. And you took that risk. Some people are even regretting the risk they took. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
So, everything we do in life involves some level of risk. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, now, for you to prosper in the kingdom of God, because of this prosperity program that God has for the church, if you must prosper, get ready to engage the level of risk that God exposes to you. Amen?
Amen.
Because if you are exposed to this level of risk and you plug yourself into it, you are sure to come out with what God has in store for you. Now, why does God's prosperity plan involve some major risk? Because the plan of God for His people is a covenant. Amen.
Amen.
Now, the plan of God, as long as prosperity is concerned, is to prosper the church. And it also involves some dangerous risk. But why is it that it involves a major risk? It's because it's a covenant. Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse 18. The Bible said, thou shalt remember the Lord your God, for it is He that giveth thee power to make wealth, that He may establish His covenant. So the reason why it involves a major risk is because God is involved with a covenant. In Psalm 89, I think in verse 34 and 35, the Bible says, my covenant will I not break, nor utter what is gone out of my lips. God signs a covenant with you because he knows that he will never fail in his covenant. I realize that when God enters into a covenant with anybody, two things are involved. Number one, his integrity and his holiness. His integrity and his holiness. In verse 35, God said, I have sworn to David my servant that I will not lie to him. He cannot lie to me. He cannot lie to me. Lion of Judah, he cannot lie to me. He cannot lie to me. He cannot lie to me. Jesus. Lion of Judah, you cannot lie to me. You cannot lie to me. You cannot lie to me. Lion of Judah, you cannot lie. Praise the Lord. So because God's covenant is involved in his plan of prosperity, you must be ready to take the risk. Praise God. Now, we have covenant fathers like Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We're going to talk more about Isaac. Now, the risk involved in Abraham's journey of prosperity, please pay attention now. In chapter 12 of Genesis, from verse 1 to verse number 4, God said to Abraham, leave your country, leave your kindred, leave your father's house to a land that I will show you. And I will bless anyone who blesses you. I will curse anyone that curses you. And in this shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. Abraham believed in verse 4. And the Bible says he departed. Now listen to this. He didn't show Abraham where Abraham was going to. That is risk. Amen?
Amen.
He didn't tell him this is the particular place to go. The young man just moved. That is a risk. You know that faith is a risk.
Yes, sir.
Abraham departed in verse 4, Genesis chapter 12. And if you flip over to the next chapter, chapter 13, verse 1, the Bible says, and Abraham was rich in cattle, in silver, and in gold. If he had remained where he was, not taking that risk, he would have been rich in cattle, in silver, and in gold. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I said, praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
God said to Abraham, I'm trying to expose some risk now involved in God's prosperity plan. Please pay attention now. God said to Abraham in Genesis chapter 22, take your son, your only son. Now, watch this now. Isaac wasn't the only son of Abraham. Abraham also had Ishmael. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
But by the time God appeared to Abraham in chapter 22 of Genesis and told him, give me your only son, he had already sent away Ishmael. If God had said to him, give me your son, he would go and look for Ishmael wherever the young man has gone to. Even though he hears the angel say, don't kill, he will kill because he wanted to end that family trouble. Once and for all. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
But God said, your only son, take him to a place that I will show you. Not that he has shown him the place. For 3 days, Abraham was looking for the place that God said, show me and that I will show you to offer his only begotten son. I mean, his only son. That is risk. You will even doubt the voice. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Let me share this testimony. I was saving money for my wedding. Then I've not even seen the wife I'm going to marry. And in those days, I was able to save up to 12,000 naira in Nigeria. And I saw it as my millions. Don't look at me like that. And one day we had a program, and one evangelist came to town, one of my colleagues, and fired some dangerous message. And began to raise some, you know, sacrificial offerings and all that. Watch. While he was calling out, started from 10,000, and I was nobody. When I mean nobody, I was just a keyboardist in the church. And I cannot pretend not to hear the voice. I heard clearly the voice of the Lord said to me, That money you have been saving for about 3 years now. Praise the Lord. Are you guys laughing at your pastor? For years. Am I still on that level now? That money you've been saving for 3 years. Come on for 10,000. I pretended as if I didn't get the points. Because I knew how long it took me to save that money. You know, I'm talking about money I've been saving for my wedding. And when the voice persisted, I lay down on my chest as I rebuke you, spirit, wherever you are coming from, back to sender. I'm telling you what I did. I started rebuking the spirit in my heart. I rebuke you in the name of the Lord. I rebuke you in the name of the Lord. After I finished rebuking, the voice of the Lord said to me, stop rebuking me. Come out for that seed. Praise the Lord. I pretended as if I didn't hear the voice. And I lost my peace. At the end of the day, I said, okay. When the voice persisted, I said, okay, I heard you. People around me were looking like, what's going on with this man? And I came out. After coming out of, you know, I hated myself. All this I give and I feel at peace, a lie. Praise the Lord. After giving that money, I hated myself. But I mean, because I took a risk. Money you save for 3 years. And now you gave out 98% of it. And I asked myself, so I'm going to spend another 3 years saving this amount. A lot of things were going on in my mind. And the devil was speaking to me. He said, you are finished. It was a risk I took. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
But you know, after that risk I took, for 3 months, I didn't know myself. But within a short while, God catapulted me to another level. Moved me to a new branch. Oh my goodness, it was just awesome. I was just 2 weeks in a new branch. Somebody looked for me. He came to the church looking for me and didn't see me. Went to the headquarters, didn't see me. Was just all around looking for me. Why are you looking for me? I never knew that God spoke to him. Go and give him a car. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And guess what? When I wanted to now marry, the money that was spent was 500 times more than the 10,000 I came out for. Come and say risk.
Risk.
Now, look at Jacob. Jacob took some level of risk and he was so prosperous. What was the risk? The father was speaking to Esau. He said, go and make me venison. I think it's Genesis chapter 28. Is it 28 or thereabout? He now said, while Esau departed, the mother of Jacob said to him, this is what your father is saying to your brother. Now prepare yourself. Go and present yourself to your father. Take the meal that we're going to prepare for him. Please pay attention now. Now watch this. Jacob made a statement. Praise God.
Yeah.
Jacob made a statement. What was the statement? He said, my father, peradventure, may discover that I am not Esau. I am Jacob. Because Esau is hairy and I am a smooth-skinned human being. And my father may curse me instead of blessing me. The mother said, let the curse be upon me, but go and do what I told you. Do you know what? Jacob took that risk, prepared everything and brought to his father. When his father heard the voice, he said, the voice is the voice of Jacob. But the smell and the skin is Esau. He said, come near my son. After he looked at him, he now blessed him. And Jacob walked away with the blessing he connivingly and deceitfully got from his father. Don't look at me like that. But God honored it. That was a risk the young man took. And that risk, praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And that risk so made him prosperous. God wants to prosper his children, but the thing is that they are afraid to take a risk. Now let's go further. Now, one thing about risk taking is this. Every risk associated with kingdom prosperity is in levels, depending on the height you are willing to attain. Every risk you will ever take in the kingdom of God is in levels, depending on the height you want to attain in the walk of prosperity. Watch this. Genesis 26, when we just, you know, took as our text. The first risk that Isaac took, pay attention now, was that Isaac took the risk of obedience to divine instruction. What was the divine instruction? People were living in droves. People were escaping for their life. And God said, remain in the city of Gerar. If you are the one that is living in Syria, where ISIS is reigning, are you with me now?
Yes, sir.
And you could see it all over town. They are beheading people. And people are escaping. And you want to also join them in the escape. And God said to you, remain here. You say, God, this is not the voice of God. Praise the Lord. Watch this. There was this young man we were talking over this, is this Skype or something like that, in Pakistan. And he told me that they're going to invite me to Pakistan. I said, I don't need your invitation. Keep it to yourself. They've not invited me in America. I'm talking about Pakistan. I told him, keep all your invitation to yourself. He said, no, Pastor, we're going to prepare for you. I said, no. I don't. We can talk over Skype. Praise the Lord. I wasn't ready to take that kind of risk. I'm just telling to tell you about risk, amen? To let you know the level, to be honest with you, my faith has not come to that level of going to Pakistan for a crusade. This is me talking to you. I don't envy those who are going to Pakistan or Afghanistan for a crusade. They have grace for that. And I will pray for them that God will encourage them. But I'm not called to go for that kind. This is me, your pastor, talking. Amen. I don't want to be walking and be looking over my shoulders. Or see people driving by a bike. No. I don't want to think about it. You say, Pastor is afraid. I'm not afraid, but God has not told me to go there. So let's just put it at that. For those that God said go there, I pray for them. More grace, more anointing. Praise the Lord. But we can talk over Skype. I think that settles it. So, obedience to divine instruction. In Isaiah chapter 1, verse 19 and 20, the Bible says, if you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. So God said to Isaac, remain in Gerar, where famine was killing people, because God has a plan of prosperity for him. And he chose to obey that divine instruction. In Joshua chapter 1, verse 8, he said, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but thou shalt meditate in it day and night to observe and to do. Because it is in observing and doing, therein lies your prosperity and you have good success. Come on, say good success. So the risk of obedience to divine instruction is one of the key to enter into this prosperity we are talking about. God giving you instruction and you obeying that instruction. Now, like I said, prosperity is in levels. I said to one sister some time ago, back home in Nigeria.
Yay!
She was married, and the husband was involved in the occult. So it's like he has used something to exchange for something. So no child. You agree with what I'm, you understand what I'm talking about. So she came to me one day, she was in the prayer powerhouse department, and she said, Pastor, please, I've been in this thing for so long. And I said, look. And I paused a bit, and the Lord gave me instruction to give to her. I said, look for 2 children in the church, a boy and a girl. Clothe them with the best you can. And she went and did the instruction I gave to her by divine revelation. After clothing those 2 children, beautiful, like bride and look at those things. I mean, bought a boy in suit and a girl in Cinderella kind of dress. That same moment she became pregnant, the husband could not believe it. Because he had exchanged his whatever in the occult. He could not believe it. Before I left Nigeria, she had 2 beautiful children. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. If she had not taken that risk or despised that instruction, forget it. Our brother gave a testimony this morning. It was by instruction. For you to enter into your wealth, into your prosperity, it comes by divine instruction. If you only listen. I had a testimony of a young man who was sacked from his job. He was a lecturer. He was sacked from his job. He was able to save some money though. After being sacked from his lecturing job as a professor. He was driving towards Onitsha one day, and he heard the voice of the Lord say to him, go and buy this land. He saw a land for sale, one plot of land. Because he knew the voice of God, he decided to obey that voice. Took part of his savings, bought the land. And while they were trying to do, you know, fencing and all that, as they were digging, they saw marble. It became a marble mine. This guy shot into millions. He shot into wealth. The same young man, praise the Lord, was driving towards another location, and he had the same voice said to him, buy this land. He quickly, he didn't waste time, he bought the land. Praise the Lord. The next time they were digging the same land he bought again, they found gold. It doesn't take God a century to change your story. It's just a divine instruction. But people are very lazy in carrying out divine instruction. Come and tell you, this week don't eat. Just eat once. I want to open you to another realm. And you look at yourself, look at the food. No, God, this thing is not from God. Praise the Lord. And that is the time hunger will wake you up very early in the morning. And maybe your wife doesn't know how she cook. Or even your wife didn't cook anything. You will pass this from the aroma of your neighbor cooking something. And your stomach will just go like this before you know it. You look for food to eat. And you miss out what God has in stock for you. Come and say, here. So, this is where many Christians struggle in the journey of prosperity, because obedience is a risk due to its nature of uncertainty. You see, obeying divine instruction has some element of uncertainty wrapped with it. Because you don't know what is going to be the outcome. And as a result, people struggle to obey. Praise the Lord. Now, what does it mean that, you know, obedience has some nature of uncertainty? Obedience is simply doubting your doubts, overcoming your fear and your prejudices in response to instructions. Doubting your doubts, overcoming your fear. Now watch this. When Peter wanted to come out of the boat, his colleagues told him, Peter, you want to kill yourself. But Peter doubted his doubts, overcame his fear and prejudices, and began to walk on the water. But the very moment he removed his eyes from the Lord, he began to sink. You will not sink.
Amen.
Brethren, you will not sink.
Amen.
So brethren, if you must prosper this end time in God's prophetic agenda, therefore you must be ready to embrace the risk of obedience. Amen.
Amen.
If Isaac had not listened to God, I mark what I'm saying today, Isaac's name would have been erased as one of the covenant fathers, because he would have missed God. Many Christians, they have missed God simply because they ignored divine instruction. Now, the second risk that Isaac took was this. Isaac took the risk of keeping his family in the midst of a hostile environment. He risked a hostile environment like we have now in Syria, with his family staying there. Now, any prosperity that takes you away from your family is not from God, it's satanic. Did you hear what I said? Some people travel to a far distant land, leaving their family, and before you know it, they are cut off from their family. It's not the will of God. Praise the Lord. No, this one may not sound well to the Western environment, but it is the truth. Isaac took the risk of keeping his family with him. How do I know? Because he had to lie just to make sure that his wife was still around. He valued his family more than anything that can be given to him. And at the end of the day, when it was discovered that indeed that woman is his wife, he had to now tell them the whole truth. If I had told you that she's my wife, I would have been a dead man. And the king said, okay, but you should have told us all this while. Thank God he didn't tell you, he now told us. Finally, Isaac was secured. If you watch this, if you watch what happened to Isaac, he entered, if not that his family was there, he would be distracted. Do you know? Watch this now. If your family is not where you are not coordinated. Because your mind is where they are. And you can't hear what God is telling you. Any prosperity that removes you from your family is satanic. It's just an opportunity the devil has created to destroy you. Come on, sir, here. And finally, the risk that Isaac took. Isaac sold in a famine condition. That was a dangerous risk. The seed he had to eat, he had to sow it. In other words, the economic climate of the environment was not a determinant factor for sowing. Isaac depended on the covenant that informed his sowing in the midst of famine. He believed in the covenant, not in the famine, but in the covenant. In the book of Genesis chapter 8 verse 22, seed time and harvest shall not cease. That was the covenant. And Isaac stood by the covenant and did what he knew best to do, and that is sowing. He sowed notwithstanding the famine condition. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I'm about winding up now. So, brethren, in Ecclesiastes chapter 11, verse 4 to 6, the Bible says, if you observe the wind, or whosoever observeth the wind cannot sow. If the circumstances of your life is what determines your sowing, you can't go forward. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
So the covenant of prosperity should be the determinant factor for our sowing, not the economic factor or the economic climate of the country that we live in. Because Philippians chapter 4, verse 19 says that my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory. Not according to the climate condition, economic condition of the country, but according to his riches in glory. So the covenant of tithing, the covenant of offering and seed sowing, the covenant of promoting the kingdom of God on the earth should be the motivation for taking the risk to prosper in the kingdom, not the circumstances that we are going through. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Watch this now. Some people, God wants to bless them, and the instruction will come, say, you do this. The next thing that will come out of their mouth is, you know what I'm going through. What are you going through? God sees what you are going through, and he has made a channel on how to come out of what you are going through. But people keep confessing, see what I'm going through. God said to Elisha, go to the woman of Zarephath. I have commanded this woman to bless you, to sustain you. Are you still here?
Yes, sir.
When Elisha got to the woman, he almost changed his mind. He said, God, are you sure? Even though I'm a prophet, I hear clearly from God, but this one is in doubt. Because the woman was gathering stick. He said, woman, can you fetch me some water? And she went to go and fetch water. Before she went, he said, come, make me some cake. He said, man of God. So what I was doing now, I was gathering this thing to prepare the last meal. Myself and my son will eat and wait for death. Elijah said, no. He said, Elijah. He said, no, you're not going to die. That thing will not run dry. Amen?
Amen.
But he said, make for me first. If he's here, you will leave the church. See, this pastor don't understand. No, am I right? If it's in our days now, you will just pack your Bible, say that church, forget it. And you will be a very terrible evangelist telling everybody in town that church, that pastor is not called of God. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
And Elijah said to her, make for me first. And the woman took the risk of making for him first. Because she stepped out to make for him first, according to the word of God's servant, he stood like that. And she prospered throughout the famine season. Let me tell us something. Next year, 2016, is a year that God is bringing sanity to the world again.
What I mean
sanity? There is so much insanity rampaging the world today. But God is going to bring sanity, but it's going to come at a cost. Watch what I'm saying now, it's on record. It's going to come at a cost. The people Satan is fronting to cause this insanity, they will be dropping dead like flies.
Yeah.
And that will send shockwaves around the world.
Amen.
When I mean shockwaves around the world. I said it earlier this year. I saw blood flowing and I've never seen things happen like this before in my lifetime. Where a human being will go to another human being and be chopping up his neck. And they'll be shouting and praising. Yeah, this is devil. But it's not going to be like that next year.
Amen.
The God the Lord God of Sabbath will arise.
Yeah.
The consuming fire himself will now come to take over.
Yeah.
And all these devils that Satan is fronting to intimidate even Christians, they will be dropping dead like flies.
Yeah.
You see how Herod was executed?
Yes.
He was giving a speech. Many of them will be giving speech. Live television, they will drop dead.
Yeah.
And that will send shockwaves around the world.
Yeah.
Because the church has come to take over.
Amen.
But watch this. The church will also prosper. When I mean prosper, that's why this message is coming this time around.
Amen.
Because God will be opening opportunities for his people.
Amen.
It's life for you to take the risk of entering that opportunity.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Doors will be opening. But have you seen Mr. Opportunity wearing suit and walking on the street? And say, I am opportunity. Nobody will wait. Nobody will even welcome it. No. He won't go far because they will tear him into business. But I've come to realize that opportunities come dressed in rags. You agree with that?
Yes, sir.
Dressed in rags, tattered clothing. Because not everybody will recognize it. May God open your eye to recognize it. Isaac recognized when God said to him, remain here. Isaac saw what every other person didn't see. He saw the fertile ground. Others were seeing the famine. So he now sowed in a land that was ravaged with famine. If you read verse 12 to verse 15 of Genesis 26, he sowed in that land. Things began to change because the Bible says in that same year, he received the 100-fold. And all those people who left town, if they had known that sowing in that land would change the situation, they would not have let down. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
I said, praise God.
Hallelujah.
Many of, thank you, Lord. I see many opportunities being opened.
Amen.
But may God strengthen your hearts to take the risk.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The righteous, they are bold as a lion. It takes some element of boldness to take a risk. If you are not convinced that God is in a thing, there's no how you can take that risk. But if you are totally convinced that God is in a thing, there's no how you will not take that risk. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I said, praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
When God said to me, my son, it is time to step out in faith and begin the work I sent you to do. Wow. And gave me the date. Wow. I didn't see the small beginning. I saw the great future. We're getting there.
Amen.
You will get there with me.
Amen.
Very soon, I can see me. You see, we'll move out of this place not too long from now.
Amen.
So that will not cause commotion on the street here.
Amen.
Because when you are coming with your Q7 and Jeep and backing everywhere,
amen,
it will create envy around you. Before you know it, they may use something and start scratching people's car because of anger. Who are these people? They are prospering, and every other person is not prospering. Because it is our time. Say to your neighbor, it's our time. And because it is our time, we will surely prosper. We will surely prosper in the name of Jesus Christ. If you check the result of the sowing of this young man, was that he had a bumper harvest. The Lord blessed him, meaning that God placed a seal on his wealth. That means nobody can touch his wealth. When the Lord blesses, who can curse? When God lifts you up, no devil can bring you down. That was what God was saying to Isaac. The Bible said, the Lord blessed him, and that means a spiritual seal over his world came on him. He waxed great. He went forward. You are going forward.
Amen.
He grew until he became very great. How do I know? This is called unstoppable growth. It got to a point that the king, the same king who asked him, so this is your wife and you told us a lie. The same king said to him, go away from us because you are now mightier than us. God is raising mighty men and women here.
Yeah.
And Isaac walked away quietly with his wealth and began to prosper again to the point that the king now had to go and sign a treaty with Isaac that you are now a great man. Tomorrow you may wake up and wipe out our country. So let's enter into a diplomatic relationship. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I said, praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
The Bible said that he dug a well, they came and took it from him because it was in their land. He dug another one, they took it from him because it was in their land. He dug the third one, they took it from him because it was in their land. When he dumped the fourth one, he said, this man is not ready to give up. And he called it Rehoboth. He said, the Lord has made room for us. We will now settle here. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
God is taking somebody to your land of Rehoboth. Somebody is entering their land of Rehoboth. Many people hearing the sound of my voice, wealth will come looking for you, knocking at your door. It will come like opportunities. In the name of Jesus Christ, if I be a servant of God, you will hear, the news will be going around town that such and such a person from this ministry, God visited him, and today is someone to be reckoned with.
Amen.
In town, nothing will be done without them consulting you.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I think this may be on record. I told you, God has shown me one some time ago that I will have something to do with the royal family. I don't know how it's going to happen. I'm telling you, I've seen it in my visions. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I said, praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I saw it. I said, who? Can any good thing come out of Nazareth? When I saw it, I said, well, but I'm not surprised because very soon it will happen.
Yeah.
And I will announce it to us.
Yeah.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
In terms of consultation.
Hallelujah.
Because we will hold the key to the solution of this country.
Yeah.
Solving problems of this nation.
Yeah.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
It will come to a time before they do anything, they will come and ask for advice.
Yeah.
Man of God, what do you say? Not what you say. What do you say? What is God saying? As they give me some time, let me consult with my father. I will tell you what the Lord is saying. And the country will be run by God's instruction. If you believe that, say amen. Are you blessed today? Tell your neighbor, are you ready to take a risk? Ask somebody for me, are you ready to take a risk? Now rise up on your feet.